All right, thanks. So yeah, nice that you all came here for the talk. So the name of my talk is Leaving Javaland, Bring Your Boots. And it's about Spring Boot for Groovy developers. So you will see some stuff from Spring and Spring Boot and how you can use it as a Groovy developer, or maybe just to learn some more about Spring that's underlying Rails. A little bit regarding myself. My name is Kevin Wittek. I'm a technical lead at GData Advanced Analytics. It's a German security company. I'm also self-employed, kind of as a consultant of my own consulting company, Styrakosoft GWR. And I'm the maintainer of Test Containers Java and the author of Test Containers Spock. Some of you maybe have been at our Test Containers workshop yesterday. If you like Test Containers, I've brought some stickers there. You can just pick them up after the talk or come and see me if you want one. All right, so what are the key learnings I want to show you in this talk? My idea of this talk is to peek a little bit behind the magic curtain, behind all the magic Spring and Spring Boot is providing to us, and also the additional magic Grails is applying on top of it. So we will look at some of the Spring's inner workings. We won't go in deep hardcore, just at a nice comfortable level, so everyone will be able to follow up. And yeah, we will discuss or see some of the cargo culture programming paradigms that we have in the Spring style of developing applications, and we maybe see where they come from. And yeah, you kind of learn or see that it's also quite neat to use Spring Boot directly as a Groovy developer with a Groovy language. So maybe you just get another option. You don't always have to do a Grails application. You can also do a Spring Boot application with Groovy, and it's a cool framework then still. So this slide or this picture I found in a Medium post and on Twitter, and it's just so funny that I wanted to show it to you. It shows the evolution of software architecture, and of course the evolution of software architecture also influences the evolution of our frameworks we are using to build our softwares. So at first we had just spaghetti-oriented architecture, copy and pasting, no real structure, and then in the 2000s it was kind of normal to have a layered architecture. Here they call it lasagna-oriented architecture, and this is kind of also the starting point for frameworks like Spring and the JEE stuff and so on. They are kind of ascending or descending from this kind of architecture style. So a lot of the concepts they enable come from this kind of architecture style. And of course, nowadays everything is microservices. Micronaut is a new framework for microservices. And we can call this ravioli-oriented architecture. And what's next? Pizza-oriented architecture, maybe. So, to those of you who are using Grails or Grails 3, starting with Grails 3, it's of course now also built on top of Spring Boot. I, until recently, thought it would be built on top of Spring Boot 1.x, but I just checked, and it's now also built on top of Spring Boot 2. So if you are building a Grails 3 application, you're kind of implicitly also building a Spring Boot application, kind of. This is just a rough overview, especially for people who have more experience with Grails, so you can see some of the different aspects if we compare them both side by side. Grails 3, or Grails in general, you can say it's a convention over configuration framework, just following the style of something like Rails, Ruby on Rails, of course. And if you look up the documentation, some of the marketing documentation of Spring Boot 2 especially, you will also see that they call it convention over configuration framework, but I personally think it's more a framework with opinionated defaults. It's a bit different than convention over configuration, and we will see this also in the demos. Then if we look at persistence, Grails, of course, using GORM on top of Hibernate, and also implementations there for NoSQL, and Spring Boot is using another Spring offspring project, Spring Data, And it has implementations for all kind of persistence technologies like JDBC, Hibernate, NoSQL and whatnot. If we look at the web layer of our framework and our applications, Grails has the Grails controllers, convention over configuration style. You give them a certain name, put them in a certain directory. And Spring Boot uses either Spring Web MVC, this is a classic controller-based programming style, or Spring Webflux, which is then a reactive programming style. And the build tool, I think nowadays Grails is only support for Gradle, but I'm not 100% sure. Spring Boot, you can either choose Maven or Gradle. Logging, logback for both of them. Templating Grails, of course, the GSPs, Groovy Server Pages, and Spring Boot supports different templates, templating engines. Dimeleaf is one classical one, but you can also use Groovy templating, but then it's not Groovy Server Pages, it's something different. It's like the Groovy HTML builder, DSL. And as an embedded server, normally Grails 3 comes with Tomcat. I'm not sure if you also can use it with Netty. Maybe you can nowadays, especially if you're using the reactive stuff. And Spring Boot, depending on what kind of dependencies you have, and depending on what kind of configuration, will either use Tomcat, embedded Tomcat, or Netty. And for the reactive programming, Grails provides the asynchronous framework, and Spring has Spring Webflux, which then incorporates Project Reactor. So, following up, I have some slides about the general architecture. I don't want to go into detail, just to give you a rough overview. And also, it's interesting that it's quite hard to find like an official diagram, official documentation, trying to visualize the architecture of a framework. So also, it seems like we, as a software industry, we don't have a real diagramming languages for visualizing the software architecture of frameworks. So you just see boxes on top of each other with different colors, but the meaning, there is maybe a meaning encoded into these different boxes and colors, but it's not common knowledge. Only the creator of the diagram knows it. So this I got from the Grails 3 book. This shows the different parts of Grails, and of course we see Spring is part of Grails. So if we look later at all the Spring stuff, Grails leverages a lot of these features. And this is an even more complex visualization of the Grails framework architecture, all these different components interacting with each other. And I got this in the Grails Slack. Someone said, oh, here, this is maybe a nice picture visualizing it. But it's there is like no official documentation, no official architecture, framework architecture documentation. If you try to find such a diagram for Spring, if you look into version 4 of Spring, nowadays we are version 5, you will find this diagram in the official documentation. And also, again, it's just blocks, it's boxes with different colors, but they have no real semantics. You have to kind of interpret it yourself. But like I said, in version 5, they've dropped it completely. So it's actually hard. If you really want to understand what the framework is doing, there is no easy high overview about how the framework is structured. You have to, I don't know, dig through the source code sometimes. And who here remembers the Spring I.O. platform, what Spring I.O. platform was? Yeah, okay. It was in 2013, Pivotal marketed something called Spring I.O. platform, and there Grails and Groovy were core parts of the Spring I.O. platform. So they really embraced Groovy back then, and Grails as a possible alternative to Spring Boot. And it's hard to find these kind of diagrams. I found this in an old blog post from Josh Long. Of course, they've burned all kind of images or documentation of this from their official docs. That's kind of interesting. So what they nowadays market, Spring platform, Spring I.O. doesn't exist anymore. They mainly market Spring Boot 2 now, and you have kind of two different stacks you can use when you want to build a Spring Boot application. Either you go reactive and use this Webflux stuff, or you have something more classic and use a servlet stack with Spring MVC. Okay, enough talking. Let's start with the first code example, and we also look at this in a demo. This is kind of the minimal code you need for writing your Spring Boot application. And I wanted to get this working in a Groovy script with grep and grapes, but I couldn't. I'm quite sure it was possible with Spring Boot 1, but with Spring Boot 2 I had some problems, and they used to have official examples, code examples in the Spring docs for how to do this with Groovy back in Spring Boot 1 times, but everything removed Spring Boot 2. You sometimes see Kotlin examples, but no Groovy examples anymore. So this is the same here, presentation mode. Okay, that's our starting point. You have this annotation, Spring Boot application. This way it becomes a Spring Boot application, and it's kind of a meta annotation wrapping a lot of different annotations, like enable auto configuration, which is kind of the Spring Boot magic, wiring everything together, component scanning. We will see what this means a bit later. And at the same time, I annotated with this this with add controller. Then basically, it has the same effect than if you are using a Grails controller. And then you have here this request mapping. This will then be mapped to the URL. We start it. Some nice color output. Okay, started. Started in 4 seconds, a bit slower than Micronaut. But if you switch from embedded Tomcat to Netty, it gets much faster, actually. Whoops. And let's check the example. So, yeah, what you would expect. But it's also not a lot of code necessary. On the other hand, this is, of course, like a dummy example. You wouldn't write an application this way in real life. But just to show, like, the minimal things that are needed. I think one of the main features or the main technologies, if you think about Spring, is the inversion of control container it provides, and that's also what Grails is using it for. Inversion of control, I've found this nice blog post from Martin Fowler from 2004 that talks and explains inversion of control and dependency injection very in detail. I can very much recommend this blog post to get the semantics a bit clearer. But yeah, here what he says about in the Java community, there's been a rush of lightweight containers that help to assemble components from different projects into a cohesive applications. Containers doesn't mean Docker containers. We're in 2004 here. Underlying these containers is a common pattern to how they perform the wiring, a concept they refer under the very generic name of inversion of control. And so, like 2004, in this time, historically, it was those lightweight containers, inversion of control containers, against Java EE, Java Enterprise. So it was another idea. And nowadays, if we think about something like Spring, we don't necessarily think of a lightweight framework, but that's where it comes from. That's the origin, a lightweight alternative to Java EE. And then, of course, one of the features it implements as an inversion of control container is the actual dependency injection. And what this means, you are just defining the interface of the collaborator you want to interact with. In this case, the movie finder, movie lister wants to use the movie finder. And then you have another outside component like this assembler. It will create the concrete movie finder implementation and will inject this dependency into the actual movie lister. That's what dependency injection is. And there are now different capabilities or different techniques how Spring implements this. So in general, that's also from the official Spring docs, the Spring Core documentation. That's what Spring does. It's just a big magic black box, the Spring container. You put in your POJOs or POGOs and add some configuration metadata, and then it produces the application for you. So that's what the Spring inversion of control container promises you. And it kind of holds to this promise. So it kind of works. So every one of you who uses Grails can admit this kind of works, this magic. And so what does configuration metadata mean? This can come in different flavors. And the classic example, you sometimes find them, if you Google for some specific dependency injection problems, you stumble upon these blog posts from 2005 or so, where they show you how to do the dependency injection with XML. And of course, the people who are already longer in the business, longer with Spring, still know this XML configuration of Spring dependency injection. You can also use the Groovy DSL for defining those dependencies, which is quite neat. But nowadays, and also what Spring Boot is advertising, is a different approach. It's annotation-based, and you have two kinds of different styles, like this component scanning annotation-based one or a declarative Java-based one. And we will look into this quickly. So the annotation-based one is just annotating your class with a special annotation, in this case component, and then the Spring container will automatically know, okay, this is the object I will have to instantiate, put into my application context, and use it to wire up dependencies. The other example is a Java-based config. Here you are annotating a class with add configuration, and then you have methods in this class that create objects, and if you annotate these methods with add bean, then Spring knows, okay, this is giving me a bean I can use for my dependency injection, and then the greeter in this example is added to the application context and can be wired. And how do I actually inject them into my other classes who want to interact with them? Easiest example, or nowadays the common way, is a constructor injection. You can add auto-wired annotation to your constructor, and then Spring automatically knows that it should add the dependencies there itself from its application context. And yeah, you see this Groovy code here. Also, you see this add controller annotation again. So here we are saying this is a Spring bean. Oh, this is managed by Spring. It has an add controller annotation. It's like a special add component. And for instantiating this object, you first need to auto-wire its dependencies, like here. Nowadays, since Spring 5, I think, auto-wired has become optional for constructor injection, so it looks actually quite neat here. You don't even need the annotation. We can quickly look how it looks in the real code. Basically the same as what you've seen. We have here this greeting controller. We have here two other dependencies, a greeter and a conference name selector. They are automatically injected there because it's constructor injection by default. You can here see IntelliJ neatly shows you the dependencies, like with Grails, basically. And then you can use them. If you would use write Java, you would normally define the dependencies here as private final, because you only want to set them in the constructor once. And here's a greeter I've annotated with add component. The conference name selector is a real POJO, so it's a real normal Java class. How does it get into the application context? It's using this configuration class, and then this method with add bean annotated will create the actual bean and populate the application context there. And yeah, the actual example is then not that spectacular. We go. Okay. This works. So, nowadays, everyone in the Spring ecosystem uses dependency injection via constructor dependency injection. You can also set this annotation onto fields or at setters, but kind of because of this blog post by Oliver Gierke, who is a technical lead of the Spring Data team, and it's a good blog post also, but everyone says, no, we do constructor-based dependency injection because Oliver Gierke sets this in this blog post. So people will always refer to this blog post, really, and it has cemented this style of doing dependency injection. One question into the room. What is for you a benefit of dependency injection? Why do you want to use dependency injection? What's your gain of it? Anyone, any ideas? Yeah, I think so too. So for me, the main benefit of dependency injection is for testing and for mocking my dependencies. And that, of course, works very well when you do constructor-based dependency injection. Because then you also see that if you instantiate your objects, you need to add this other collaborator, and you have to think about, do I want to mock them, stub them, whatever. So I think it goes hand in hand. But of course, there are other ways to inject the dependencies. For my test. Yeah, so the one answer is that in your tests, you then have to define, or you have a real complete object after instantiating it, because you need to provide all dependencies, either stubbed one or real ones, and then you always have the real object to test with. You don't do after the object creation, set the dependencies using setters or whatever. That's the one reason. And the other reason is it makes the dependencies of your class really, really visible, because you will get a big constructor if you have a lot of dependencies. For example, if you have 10 dependencies, 20 dependencies, you have an enormous constructor, and it's very hard to use in your unit test. On the other hand, if you use field injection, you kind of loses information, or it's not explicit anymore. It looks still like a very clean class, but it is not anymore. It has really a lot of dependencies that are kind of hidden in there. Yeah, these are the some of the annotations that are available in Spring. You can use AutoWire to say, I need a dependency here. It also supports the JSR annotation inject, so that's the official Java one. Component for annotating the class, for component scanning, and here service controller repository are like special stereotypes of component. Sometimes they have a bit of additional functionality, like controller. Service, for example, is just a syntactic or semantic to give you documentation like semantics. It doesn't change the behavior. You can scope these beans, like you also know it from Grails, I suppose. Like, as default, they will always be a singleton, so every class has the same object there, or you can scope it for request, whatever. And the configuration annotation then allows you to define beans in there. Okay, the other really big part of what Spring and the Spring IOC provides you is the possibility to have aspect-oriented programming capabilities. And I found this nice quote, and I think it's from a paper published at the European Conference on Object-Oriented Programming in 1997, and I think this was the first paper on the concept of aspect-oriented programming. And it says what aspect-oriented programming is. We have found many programming problems for which neither procedural nor object-oriented programming techniques are sufficient to clearly capture some of the important design decisions the program must implement. We call the properties these decisions address aspects, and show that the reason they have been hard to capture is that they are cross-cut the system's basic functionality. We present the basis for a new programming technique called aspect-oriented programming that makes it possible to clearly express programs involving such aspects, including appropriate isolation, composition, and reuse of aspect code. So who of you is using aspect-oriented programming consciously, and what are the kinds of cross-cutting concerns you are solving with it? Anyone has something they are doing with this? You're right, it makes it sometimes difficult to understand, but I think some of you are using it. For example, transactional annotation, that's an aspect. And that's actually the main purpose Spring is using it for in the core. So for having the same transaction management as Java EE had back then with Enterprise Java Beans, and it also allows you to implement aspects yourself, leveraging Spring. And another aspect, a useful thing, aspect-oriented programming, Spring Security. It's completely aspect-oriented, having these annotations at the methods. Another example you can think of that might be useful for aspects are really mechanical cross-cutting concerns like loggings or timing metrics and so on. They can be very useful, but as you said, it makes the actual control flow, it obfuscates the actual control flow and makes it harder to understand what's happening underneath. And here we look how Spring implements it, and at least in Grails 2, it was leveraging this implementation also heavily, as far as I know at least. It creates dynamic proxy classes, so this Java feature of dynamic proxy classes, and then it allows for runtime weaving of these aspects. So weaving means injecting these aspects into my program code, into my program flow, and it does it as runtime when it assembles the application. There's also support for AspectJ, and this also allows for compile time weaving of these aspects. And maybe I'm wrong with this, but I would say all the Groovy transformations, compile time transformations, are often could be considered as runtime weaving of aspects into your compile time weaving of aspects into your code. So AST transformations also kind of can weave aspects into your code. And yeah, if you're using a proxy, every time this collaborator was injected in your code, it has then the proxy, and if it calls the method foo, it will not call it on the object, it will call it on the proxy. The proxy will do his cross-cutting stuff in there, and then will delegate it to the actual object. But there is something you have to be careful, and what I've seen with, yeah, kind of strange bugs or strange behavior you can't explain is that this keyword becomes something or has a different meaning than sometimes when used from a proxy. So we have this simple POJO example. We have a method foo and it calls the method bar, and the method bar has an aspect there by specifying this add transactional annotation. And if now the outside collaborator calls the method foo on the proxy, it will delegate the method foo to the actual object, and this then will call bar on itself. So it will then not go to the proxy, and it will not go through the aspect that has been specified with the annotations. So on the other hand, if you call bar directly, it will go through the proxy, and the aspect will be applied. So that's what's happening in Spring when you call methods from the same class and you want to leverage the proxy functionality. You have to keep this in mind. And there are different workarounds for this, dirty workarounds, like instead of using this, trying to get the proxy from the application context, or just put it into another class and then inject this class into this class, and then you will always go through the proxy. Okay, and in Grails 3, before Grails 3.1, also transactions were implemented using this proxy style, but now instead Grails uses an AST transformation for the transactional annotation. That's what I found in the official documentation. Let's look at persistence. So persistence, as I said, Spring Boot suggests to use Spring Data here. There are different technologies that are supported, JPA, JDBC, LDAP, and whatnot. NoSQL databases like Mongo, Cassandra. And Spring Data does it by using the repository pattern. And yeah, it really starts to feel like a history lesson here. So the repository pattern has first been described by Martin Fowler in the book Patterns of Enterprise Application Architecture. And it says the repository mediates between the domain and data mapping layers using a collection-like interface for accessing domain objects. And this is not exactly how Spring Data implements it. This is the pattern he described in this book. But you have here's a client, and for accessing the person, it will go through this repository class, and the repository class can have different implementations there, like an in-memory implementation, a JDBC-based implementation, a NoSQL-based implementation, and you're abstracting yourself from the actual implementation of your persistence layer, which is a nice thing. But the way Spring Data does it is it uses the repository definition from the domain-driven design book by Eric Evans, and here it says a long listing, but I think it's a really good definition. It's a good definition to understand what why they choose to do it this way. The repository, it provides query access to aggregates expressed in the ubiquitous language. For each type of aggregate that needs global access, create a service that can provide the illusion of an in-memory collection of all objects of that aggregate's root type. Set up access through a well-known global interface. Provide methods to add and remove objects which will encapsulate the actual insertion or removal of data in the data store. Provide methods that select objects based on criteria meaningful to domain experts. Return fully instantiated objects or collections of objects whose attribute values meet the criteria, thereby encapsulating the actual storage and query technology, or return proxies that give the illusion of fully instantiated aggregates in a lazy way. So, from Eric Evans, originally written in 2003, and this quote is from a small condensed version of domain-driven design, referent from 2014. How does it then look in reality? Okay, we have at first the classic JPA Hibernate entity here, but we are not calling any query methods or so on this object. Instead, we are using the repository interface. And I'm not a big Rails user, but I assume it's similar to the GORM data services. And what you do is you have yourself an interface. You extend from CRUD repository and say this should be an interface for the book class and for the primary key that is along. And here you can define then, a bit like the GORM dynamic finders, you can define methods, and they are automatically at runtime kind of parsed, deconstructed into the actual SQL, for example, SQL statements when the application boots. Not when calling it, when the application boots, it creates all these methods. And this is an example of defining a custom method on the CRUD repository. It already has a number of kind of useful methods like save all, find by ID, delete all, and whatnot. And yeah, we again look to the example. We have here the book. It's an entity, and the book repository just has this name. This param is for something different. I'll show in a while. And then the book controller will simply use the repository as a dependency. It's injected here, and then you can call, for example, here's this find all method. Then use Groovy to put it to JSON. Not so bad looking, actually. So if we look at the books, we see we currently have two books in here, and we can, what was the method? By name. Search for a book here. Yeah, so kind of works like expected. But there's also another, I don't know if I would say a nice feature, but it's sometimes a convenient feature for some use cases, and that's Spring Data REST. If you want to use it, you have to just include the dependency, and then Spring Boot does its auto-configuration magic. So in general, in Spring Boot, if you want to use something, you normally just add some dependencies, and then depending on the dependencies Spring Boot is seeing there, it tries to configure your application in a useful way. So this is an opinionated configuration. And now if we look at what it generates for us, what functionality it generates for us, we have now this REST endpoint that shows us all Spring Data repositories that are directly available via REST interface. So we have this other here with beers, for example. And if I look into the source code, we have here the beer entity, nothing special. and we have just the beer repository here, but we have no beer controller. But it kind of automatically, like scaffolding, like created this functionality for us. And we are adding here the at param annotation, because starting with Java 8, the compiler will remove the names of the interfaces if you're not setting the dash parameter option when compiling, and then it doesn't know anymore how to map this string, as far as I know. So this is just to tell tell Spring map the type parameter in the query. And so yeah, this is what it looks like. We can go here. This is as a default endpoint, then just listing everything. And we have here like some things it implements. It implements, for example, a search functionalities. And then if we click here, we see basically the methods our repository has. So here it's a find by type. If we click here, it will not work because it can't render here. But if we just type it in manually, yes, this will then automatically go to our Spring data repository. But of course, you are like, I wonder in which use cases you directly want to expose your repository as a REST interface. There might be useful sometimes, but normally you want some kind of business logic, and if you want to add this, it again gets kind of hacky. So this is more like a demo conference show of thing, for me at least, so I have not used it in a constructive fashion. Or if I try to use it in a constructive fashion, at one point I was seeing its limitations and then switching back to using real controllers again. Okay, let's come to the final chapter, my favorite chapter. It's about testing. How can you test your Spring Boot application? You can test this with Spock, of course. If you want to unit test your code, like real unit test, you can do it just like any other unit test without caring about Spring. So, because for me at least, a real unit test doesn't involve the framework I'm using. It should be more atomic, just my classes. And since we are already using things like dependency injection and so on, it's normally should be quite easy in a well-architected Spring application to unit test my core business logic. But it also has some nice features for integration testing, a special annotation we will see. You can use custom configuration classes to set up the application in a special way for you. You have a mock MVC client for interacting with the controllers. And the same thing for Webflux, kind of. And you can mock the dependencies, the other beans your classes are interacting with Spock, starting with Spock 1.1. They have kind of support for this now also. So, yes, simple smoke test. You can just use the Spock Spring extension. Where is it? Here. Spock Spring. Then Spock neatly integrates with Spring. You annotate your class with @springboottest, and then it will completely start the application context of Spring for your test. And here we just basically look if the application context loads, which is already a nice smoke test, because it shows you that all your dependencies are satisfied and so on. So it takes some time, and then we see it works. Web MVC test, we can add web MVC annotation here. We can auto-wire us this MVC client, and then this has this kind of builder-like DSL to do interactions with our controller. And I think in this case it's not really creating a web server. Instead, it's like interacting with the API there directly, mocking away the web server layer. So this looks like this, although we have already more here. Exactly. How can we mock with Spock? So with Spock, we have the problem if we want to use stubs and mocks. You normally can only define them in your test methods. But if you do it there, then the Spring application context is already started, and then you didn't inject the stubs or mocks in there, and they are maybe missing. So a feature Spock provides for this is a detached mock factory, and there you can define stubs and mocks outside of your actual test methods. And if you then annotate this methods that create these mocks or stub with @bean and the whole class with @testConfiguration, Spring will use it for its dependency injection. And that's what we see here. We want to test the greeting controller, but we don't want to instantiate the whole application. We just want to instantiate this controller and stub away its dependencies. Mm. Therefore, we have here this @testConfiguration. And define a greeter stub, a conference name, selector stub. They are both beans. And then they can be auto-wired into our test. And then we can stub them like we would expect from a normal Spock test. So I think currently the Mockito support is kind of nicer. You can directly annotate them here with @mock. That doesn't work for Spock for now. It's also a bit more complicated to get this into. I know there's a lot of discussion in the Spock issue about this, but it's not so trivial, but maybe doable one day. Yeah. But you can do it, basically. And last not but least, you can of course also test your Spring Boot application using test containers and Docker containers for your integration test dependencies. And here we have this example. We look directly in the code. It's more fun. So, for everyone who doesn't know, test containers, it's a Java library for spinning up your external dependencies like a database in Docker containers from your JUnit tests, JUnit integration tests. And here we have a Postgres container we want to use for testing our data repository, book repository. And what we have to do now, and this is kind of tricky, we now have to get into the correct point in the Spring Boot application lifecycle, because we need to inject the actual runtime configuration, like the port, the URL of our database, before the complete Spring Boot context, the Spring context is initialized, because it will try to create a data source and check the connectivity. So we have to be like fast in the lifecycle before the application context is there. And a simple way is to use Spring Boot's configuration resolving possibilities. So you can simply set system properties, environment variables, and whatnot to set the actual settings for the app, for the system under test in this case. So here set the JDBC URL, and normally you would then in the clean spec clear these properties again, or else they will pollute your JVM. But I have omitted this detail here. And here our test is then just checking that we can save a book. And yeah, now Spring is starting. This exception is okay. This is some feature from the Postgres driver missing. We see here the container has been started, the database container. Yeah, and the build was successful. So the test was successful. All right. So, conclusion. Just wanted to show you some stuff of Spring Boot, what you can do with Spring Boot, that it's all also not that hard, and that you can maybe now see a lot of stuff Grails is using underneath for providing maybe nicer or more convenient functionalities. And in the end, if you're happy with Spring Boot, use Spring Boot. If you favor Grails, if you feel good with Grails and with the applications you need to build, just use Grails, or try out the new Micronaut. And yeah, you can use all of them with Groovy in a nice fashion and improve your developer experience. And that's all. Here are the sources for the example project I've shown. Any questions? Okay, thank you.